Harper Wave and Harper Audio present Southern Women. More than 100 stories of visionaries, artists, and icons. By Amanda Heckert and the editors of Garden and Gun. Foreword by Allison Glock. Read by Megan Tusing, Coleen Marlo, Janina Edwards, Robin Miles, Eileen Stevens, and Adenrele Ojo.
Introduction. Grit and Grace. When we named Garden and Gun back in 2007, we wanted to evoke a love of the land, a sensibility that adds depth to the stories we tell about the South and the way we live here. But when I think about those two words, I also can't help but recall my grandmother's. I wrote once in an early issue about how those two women represented the essence of not only the garden and the gun, but also grit and grace. My maternal grandmother, we called her Mama, lived on a tobacco farm in North Carolina, where she raised my mother and five other children. Summer days spent with Mama were magical, gathering eggs, riding tractors, eating fresh-picked watermelon on the front porch. My paternal grandmother lived in the little town of Warrenton, North Carolina, and her social graces were impeccable. Our visits were announced in the local paper, and while she and my grandfather were not well off, she set a beautiful table. Sparkling goblets, lovely linens, and plates full of perfect biscuits and bacon. Like many Southern women, grandmother and mama, different though they may have seemed, each possessed both grit and grace, and I like to think I inherited those traits from them. Growing up in Columbia, South Carolina, I did nothing by half measures. Instead of giving an ordinary book report on Pippi Longstocking, I dressed up as the irrepressible redhead and bounded into the classroom in character to tell my tale. I graduated at the top of my class in high school, and I fully attribute this drive to do just a little bit more than everyone else, and to try to do it better, to my mother and father. He was a college professor and she was a former English teacher, and they encouraged me at every turn to spread my wings, to do anything I set my mind to. In retrospect, that work ethic, that grit, and the grace I learned as a woman growing up in the South were both key to my success in the magazine world. I moved to New York after college and quickly made my mark selling retail advertising for GQ magazine, creating a new nationwide business of in-store promotions for guys, a first in the men's magazine world. When I was named the first female publisher of The New Yorker, the announcement made a splash, but I was focused on the gargantuan task of turning around what was at the time a money-losing magazine. Invariably, I would be asked throughout those years in New York, "Isn't it difficult to be a Southern woman in business in the Big Apple?" I always balked at the question. It wasn't until I returned to the South in 2004, following stints at Mirabella and Fortune, that it occurred to me that perhaps I did approach business differently because of my Southern roots. When I first went over to The New Yorker as an associate publisher, an interviewer asked me why the publisher wanted me, and I answered, "I think he knows I'll bust my ass." But looking back, that willingness to work hard was also aided by a little bit of Southern savvy, that ability to know how to sweeten your asks, to get people to see your side, to be fair and gracious to those you meet and manage. It certainly took that same pluck to get Garden and Gun off the ground. When we first proposed the idea of a national magazine and brand about the South, no doubt we were looked at askance, and we experienced our bumps in the road along the way. But we knew that by celebrating the best of the Southern lifestyle, with spirit and soul, and by sharing captivating stories, we could appeal to an audience that was underserved, one that craved compelling writing about the land they loved. One of the great privileges of this job has been meeting and spending time with our readers over the years, many who remind me of the fearless, funny, smart, driven, dynamic women from across the region whom you'll meet in the following pages. Musicians, writers, chefs, actors, designers, entrepreneurs, artists, public servants, and more. From the MacArthur genius singer-songwriter-instrumentalist Rhiannon Giddens, to the Oscar-winning legend Sissy Spacek, to the queen of Creole cuisine Leah Chase, to Pulitzer-winning poet Natasha Trethewey, to the Wall Street powerhouse and another South Carolinian who turned New York on its head, Darla Moore. Through interviews, odes, essays, and more, these world changers paint a portrait of the Southern woman today. Strong, richly diverse barrier breakers who have thrived because of, and in some cases despite, the South. Women whose stories for too long have been overlooked or underestimated. My teenage daughters, Lily and Sasa, are my highest accomplishments. My hope is that I've been able to pass down the grit and grace that run through my family and so many others in the South, and that they see themselves reflected in these portraits of risk-taking, big-dreaming Southern women. I think they will. Rebecca Wesson Darwin, President and CEO, Garden and Gun, Charleston, South Carolina.
Foreword. Soul of the South. In 2011, I wrote an essay for Garden and Gun on why Southern women are inherently different. That essay generated more response than anything I've published, before or since, in a nearly 30-year writing career. Most of the feedback was positive, some was less so. But the passion behind both the writing and the reading of that initial exploration into Southern womanhood could not be denied, and led the editors of Garden and Gun and me to start discussing the possibility of this book. We Southern women may not agree on all things, but we certainly have opinions. And that very willingness to hold and share our convictions is a kind of cultural glue. It is an admittedly tricky thing to summarize a subset of people, to generalize, to group. Inevitably, there will be those who argue, rightly, that they don't fit into the mold. And yet, over my years of interviewing dozens upon dozens of Southern women, never mind being raised by many, I've found those women to be the first to assert their own social distinctiveness, often with pride, always with ownership. Southern women identify as Southern women. And whether that means drinking sweet tea, or lassoing bucks, or walking barefoot in sun-dappled hollers, or graduating summa cum laude from Spelman, or galloping thoroughbreds across a carpet of bluegrass, or dancing at cotillion, or sweating over a low country boil, or singing soul-swelling gospel in church. The imprint of Southernness remains. Despite the reflexive stereotyping that happens around all things Southern and all things female, Holly Hunter is not Sandra Bullock, who is not Jesmyn Ward, who is not Octavia Spencer, who is not Nina Simone, who is not Beyoncé, who is not Dolly Parton. Justice Shelby is not Malin, who's not Truvy, nor Weezer, nor Annell, nor Clary. But Southern is as Southern does. And when it comes down to it, the granular particulars fade in the beam of our uncommon commonalities. Southern women recognize themselves in each other. We suss it out, and we smile at the detection. We draw together like magnets, especially when we're no longer in the South, and finding a kindred spirit feels like nothing so much as quenching a thirst. It is a relief to feel at home in the company of another, to not have to explain your peculiarities, to jettison shame, to laugh as loud as you please. Southern women, regardless of where we hail from in the region, share a consciousness of certain truths, a lean toward humor and humility and hard work, a tether, whether we like it or not, to the landscape, an impulse to give, a yearning for glory. We take the ingredients we're handed and make delicious gumbo. We leave nothing out. We prefer it that way. We also carry in ourselves a brutal, burdensome history, an awareness of wrongs that can never be made right. We plant flowers anyway. The first Southern woman who shaped me was my grandmother. She spent most of her years in a no-stoplight West Virginia factory town where she knew everyone, and everyone she knew worked long shifts in dank, dusty halls, making fancy dishware for restaurants in cities they'd never visit. This did not stop her from curling her hair and painting her face every day. A habit less about vanity than self-respect. A refusal to let anyone look down his or her nose at her simply because she lived along the tar-stripped roads of Appalachia. She taught her three daughters the same, to stand up straight, to carry themselves with dignity and class, to have manners, to be unimpeachable in the larger world, should they have the good fortune to find themselves amid it one day. My Aunt Jill was a tomboy, the type of southern girl who raised tadpoles and spent as many hours as possible among animals of all sorts. Her sister Jody was a firecracker, mouthy and funny with no appetite for bullshit, unless it was her own. My mother was the eldest, a local beauty queen who worked her way through college at West Virginia University, even though her father assured her she could meet a husband at home. Instead, she met her spouse, my birth father, the first day of freshman year. He asked her out for an ice cream sundae. If he'd asked me to go for a drink, I'd have said no. They married, she got pregnant, he left. Still, she stayed in school, raising an infant with the help of neighbors who took pity on the pretty young co-ed and her baby girl, leaving boxes of canned goods and homemade pound cake at the rental apartment doorstep. My mother was a different sort of Southern woman than her mother and her sisters, but they shared a collective spine, a familiar hunger. West Virginia was in their bloodstream, and all had hillbilly pride, even as they knew the folly of such. I inherited said pride, the chippiness of a child reared in an overlooked class on donated beans and cake. And I carry it with me now, that same spine, the same hunger that my female ancestors had. So it is for all Southern women, this inescapable infusion of the past, the ghosts of what came before us as distracting and faded as a moth batting a porch light with its wings. Southern girls come of age in a land riven with contradiction and cruelty. The South is not simple or unsullied, and we see no reason to believe otherwise. Say what you will about the saccharine ethos of the Southern Belle. On matters that matter, Southern women do not pretend. We see it all, in all of it. Ugliness knotted with beauty, glorious blankets of kudzu that strangle the trees, frogs that serenade like jazz ensembles, longhorn skulls bleached to ivory in the Texas sun. We understand life is gravy. That there is no true separation between one thing and another. That mercy can be found in the foulest well, wisdom in pockets of madness. As such, we crave vinegar as much as we crave sugar. We welcome excess and flavor and drama and music and being moved by the spirit. We know life is one giant drag show, and we dress accordingly. Over my lifetime, I've met so many Southern women who have taught me how to behave, how to misbehave, how to love, how to leave, how to be a mother, how to be a child. My sisters, warm but tough Southern mamas, who will spit needles as easily as they set a welcoming table if you cross them or their kith and kin. Miss Elaine, a surrogate mother of absolute grace and graciousness, who inspires me to stand taller, to be better than I believe I am. Friend and poet Nikki Finney, who brings me to tears nearly every time we speak. So brimming is she with fire and hope, her talent a rebuke to the world's brutality. My cherished girlfriends, Melissa, who left Texas but carries its big-heartedness with her everywhere. Misty, whose fizzy eccentricities make me feel drunk with happiness. And Peggy, who can do everything from bake a perfect chocolate cake, to play fiddle, to paint portraits of her daddy, a gal for whom nothing seems too challenging. A quality I've found more often than not among Southern women, who can always be counted on to get the job, any job, done. I recently visited Tennessee to call on Peggy and my other female confidants there. We all made supper together, swirling around the small kitchen as if dancing, touching each other's shoulders and hips as we inched past, pots aloft. We talked about news and children and okra and cancer, and how fat we were all getting, and how little, in the end, we really cared. After hours at the table, bellies full of garden tomatoes and bourbon, we headed to the piano in the foyer, where we began to sing. Lee played guitar, Peggy the accordion. Biz thumped her chest like a drum, while Lois swayed with my ailing dog Milton, cuddling him like an infant. Julie picked the first few songs, long-forgotten old-timey murder ballads. We all joined in on the choruses, our voices swelling and warbling the pitch-black lyrics that somehow made us feel full of brio. My daughters snuggled together on a nearby couch, smiling at that darkness, seeing in real time how a group of women can turn tragedy into harmony, can leaven the sorrow of life by bathing it in light. This is what Southern women do. We come together to make the best of the world as it is, while nudging the world to be better than it has been. And we do it hand in hand, arms linked, voices rising. To be a Southern woman is to be forever safeguarded in a sisterhood that reaches hundreds of miles. One that will be there in the gloaming and the dawn. Singing. Allison Glock.
I cannot talk about the South without talking about Black women. A Golden Shovel After Lucille Clifton by Ashley M. Jones for Southern Women. My grandmothers made America, made the fibers that made us warm, made us invincible heroines. To tell you who they are, I must start with who they are not. Servants, kitchen-bound mammies, silently obedient wives. We can't, in our modern comforts, imagine the survival they learned was theirs to claim, can't hold the light they burn through this colonial darkness. What tricks this nation, this American South, pulled minute by minute to keep my grandmothers convinced? The body you're in is not enough. Your race and your gender work together to mark you less, to mark you takeable. But what they didn't know was that my grandmother still had an unmovable strength, enough to build a bridge from here to heaven. I know when I leave this broken earth, I'll find them there, sweetening every hour. My grandmothers raised a generation of American men. There is no other way to say this. Look at any other Southern family and you'll find, somewhere, and a past most will not claim, a Black woman. These men who call themselves bootstrapping and self-made, somewhere there's a Black woman and her unthanked hands who lifted them to where they are now. My father tells a story of the sons of his grandmother's employers, how they, instead of the pension she was promised, decided to give her a damned old tire, an old suitcase dusty in the yard. What thanks is this for the years she raised that family, for the care they cannot forget? My father could never forgive those men, their Southern tradition, their American tradition. Even now, they tell us Black women are going to save this whole nation with votes or magic or our style taken and renamed. But this is no longer the land of massas and mammies, and we are only superheroines for our own daughters and sons. My grandmothers did not give their lives for me to keep nursing this country, to keep shucking and jiving in a bizarro American dream. My grandmothers are worth more than this corrupt remembering. Now, there is no room for the Dixieland lie. We no longer hold these truths you made us accept. Under God, yes, we hear him singing a song of powerful love despite the united hate of America. Grandmothers, women made of salt and spirit, you are faith.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.